Good minds, and welcome back to Munich, Germany. We are here just kicking off day two of Solana Stellosphere. My name is Savannah Peterson, with the fabulous Rob Strecce by my side, guiding us through our Munich journey, taking us to the fun restaurants. Thank you for that, Rob.
That was fun last night.
Right?
I think, you know, again, it was very interesting soccer match going on, or football.
Don't tell the Germans. They don't like the result.
I know. It was, you know, Barcelona was played out of their minds last night, and there was a lot of interesting cards and stuff going on. So even being downtown, but we won't go there. There was a lot of upset people in the pub.
Well, thankfully, there's no upset people on this desk. Eugenio, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And you know, talking about football, my boss is a Bayern Munich fan, so it was intense yesterday.
Oh my gosh! Yeah, and probably. Maybe not feeling so good this morning.
I don't know. I need to see him. So, but, yeah. No, but it's a pleasure to have you here again for the second year. That's amazing. And yeah, all yours.
Well, we love it. We've had so many fascinating conversations with your customers. It's actually been really inspiring to hear how they're realizing value. You lead the strategy and innovation team, so you're on the side of helping the new magic happen. I know you were on a panel yesterday. We were here chatting with some of your fabulous customers during that. Could you give us the highlights and a bit of an overview of what you talked about?
Well, yesterday the panel was quite interesting because we had the godfather of process mining. We had the founder of Gartner, the definition of process mining quadrant, Mark Kellerman, and Will van der Laas. And then we had one of the most innovative CIO in Europe, Filippo Catalano, currently the CIO of Reckitt. And we went through, the theme was let's go in a time machine. So it was basically, let's talk about use cases that are adopted mainly today, and then question about the future. And I made a joke, I said, but future, let's not talk about here now. And we'll basically...
There's a conversation about the future that doesn't involve AI.
Yeah, I think there are things that are undervaluated at this point in time that can be done. And, you know, going quickly around the three of them, Will was talking about a lot of things that are not really yet adopted en masse. You know, the adoption of object centric and what really process intelligence is has a huge potential. When you think about, we are becoming de facto a new class of data that we generate. And with that, you can do many more things. Like you can now do also predictive process mining, like generating data and then do some probably better simulation. Mark was telling about this new notion of if you have now a great process intelligence, how the future business orchestration is going to look like. And then Filippo talked about the notion, it's very trendy in the CIO community, this notion of self-healing enterprise. So it's the automation of the automation. So how can you, thanks to the process mining, the signals, you don't only fix, but you keep monitoring and you keep fixing. It's very, very interesting. And then for sure, we have great ideas. So we really want to combine those three trends and see how this can be more modern and measured in a new business model.
Yeah, and I think when we were talking earlier, one of the customers had come in, they were using the credit block application to go and do that credit monitoring. And in fact, when things go through and it's unblocked using, I think, one of the network, or not network, but one of the integrations with Teams that you've done with one of your partners, that kind of innovation where they would go unblock it in Teams, it actually goes through and they let it go through. Because help us understand how things like that get started and that one in particular.
Yeah, so that's one thing we do. I'm so proud because the keynote was like, I was so proud because most of the announcements were Labs babies.
Yeah.
And especially the joint venture we are doing with Rolio is quite exciting because if you think about the notion of what we do in this community and COE expertise, now Rolio, what can do? It can basically subscribe to process exceptions. And then make sure that he brings people that usually might not log in Solaris, might even not log in a normal system, because they might be on the street. You know, usually sales people, they don't like to volunteer. They just want to use a collaboration channel, WhatsApp, call their boss, close deal. And in that case, it's really interesting because what we do there is Rollio is subscribing to process exception, and then it creates a hybrid orchestration between human, but human is in control. It's you can imagine like a reverse copilot. It gets the exception, then they are very expert in natural language, and they create from a Celonis signal, they create in a natural language way, hey, this has happened, create a new, imagine a new channel, a new chat. They know who to invite. Maybe a credit block is based on you need a credit manager, you need the sales rep, you need someone in finance, and usually they use three different systems, and they might have three different opinions. But because of the horizontality of process intelligence, we can provide a contextual thing, and they can just focus on agreeing on what to do next. Now, the beauty is it's all auditable, and it learns from solving this problem, and it becomes a new observation in process intelligence. The early customer we are doing with is now already validating and see that people really love it, because they don't feel they are logging into a system. It's in a natural conversation.
It's meeting them where they already are.
Exactly.
Rather than taking them somewhere else, which I think makes it such an intuitive user experience and probably makes tool adoption a lot easier.
Yes.
I would assume. So, what a cool job you have. I mean, between the labs and the joint ventures, there's a lot going on. If you can share, how many projects are you working on at the same time?
So we actually have a 70-20-10 model.
Mm-hmm.
70, we always focus on a big rock. So we want to get something like this year, Network was one, and Rollio. Also the partnership we did with Ardoc, which is amazing. So we are really creating this end-to-end process and enterprise digital twin. And then we have the 20, so which basically our team has freedom. And 10 is really like every day we might come with an idea, but we kill a lot. And what we do, I tell you, it's quite funny, we have a stellar grave. We have a graveyard. Every time we kill a project, we celebrate it. Because a failure must be celebrated to learn and to go fast to the next thing.
Yeah. That's a very Silicon Valley attitude.
Yeah.
I love that. I come from Palo Alto, and I think that matters. One of the things I've been really impressed with this week is how quickly new projects and initiatives get out and how quickly your customers really feel that impact and value and achieve that ROI from that. How quickly are projects cycling out? How do they graduate from labs? What does that look like?
Yeah, we have like an handshake with our product engineering organization. Usually we are also responsible for incubation. Now, if I were working in a consumer company like, you know, Meta, whatever, it's easy. You just roll it out and then whoever uses it. We are in a tough market. It's enterprise.
Yeah.
So you have to work with customers. So it takes time. So usually you need to talk with 100, and then out of 100, maybe you get 5 that will be the first adopter.
Mm-hmm.
And then from the 5, you get 15. And then that's where 15 become paying customers,
mm-hmm.
and then from there, we scale. If you think about Orchestration Engine, was another joint venture we did. We launched it actually beginning 2023.
Mm-hmm.
Beginning 2024, we had already almost 15 customers, and then we graduated. And now it's actually everywhere. So we have many, many customers. It went smooth because the more you validate in the beginning, the better it is.
So you throw a graduation party then, the same way you celebrate?
Yeah, it's like you feel like your baby is going now to university. You miss it.
Yeah.
So let's talk about Network, because Network to me was one of those really interesting ones, and we talked about it a little bit yesterday. To me, you know, I liked how Alex went through all of the different, you know, music and tying it to ERP and CRM. To me, Network, it kind of is the graduation of EDI and how the because it's not just the exchange of data and information, it's the actual involvement of the process across companies and things of that nature. Talk to how that came, kind of came about as well.
Yeah, I mean, the hypothesis was we want to, if you are in your own enterprises, you observe process, you focus on process and performance and value. If you want to be across companies, you need to focus on shared outcomes. And what we did with Network was actually to make sure that all the network participants agree to join into a shared taxonomy. So every, you know, to join a network, everybody needs to know that an order is the same order for me, for you, and for others, and that makes things super faster, super simple.
So that's the harmonization of like the data catalog.
It's really platform.
Yeah.
We are really simple, and it's not like something new.
Yeah.
It's like it existed already, but before all of this communication, when either EDI, email, people were calling each other, there's a delay. And now with the first cluster, we saw already like an exponential impact then in the observation aspect of it. Like manual rework went down, optimization, delivery time, all of these things. Because now companies have observability not only on their own process, but how their own processes are impacted by others, especially the team processes. And that's super exciting. So again, it's at the moment we are in beta, and we are in the phase of handing over and working together with our product organization to scale. That's why it's beta. We will soon go in limited availability.
What's your gate to go to limited availability? Is the number of customers adopting? Is it the how you see the maturity of it? Or how do you think about that?
We have some internal methodology. So yeah. What is beta? What is LA? What is GS? So between beta and LA, there are some internal things like now you can be legally, you still be able to have productive software. Well, when you are in beta, there are things that, customer willing to co-innovate.
Right.
And we are also willing to say from one day to another to pivot. That's why it's more like a free environment. While then it graduates, it becomes, okay, now it has to be more like productive use cases.
Something that struck me as well is how many different verticals Celonis works with. It's not just that you're great for, say, healthcare or great for tech companies. You're great for a variety of different businesses. When you're rolling out these betas, how do you choose who gets invited? Are you selecting that based on how you think it'll be a fit, or is that because you've heard from customers that they may need this type of solutions you're developing? What does that process look like?
Good question. I feel we are more like a venture capitalist because we provide a nice platform, which we believe has a strong competitive advantage, the USP, which is the data and the process data and business context. However, we cannot know any domain. So yesterday, as an example, I was talking with a biotech company. They came with a beautiful idea. Cannot talk too much, maybe it's my next year, Salesforce topic. But it's really, we want to have other embracing the platform, embracing the power, what this can do. Because, company became big because they were able to scale. And scale is not scaling with your own people. It's either you automate or either you embrace knowledge from others. And that's what we want to do. That's why this strong commitment to our partner ecosystem is super important. And we started to see many, many things. One thing I want to mention is Bloom Filter. They do actually process mining for software lifecycle. And they came to us that, guys, we are expert in software lifecycle, but we don't want to build a full stack. We want to own our IP in that. And we said, yeah, we are good in platform. Go ahead. And now it looks very promising. Their booth is full since yesterday.
Wow. So it kind of varies case by case, essentially, is what I got from that. I'm really curious where you get to see everything first. Actually, no, I have two more questions for you. So what is the ideation process like within the group? How do you have weekly meetings where everyone throws in ideas? Is it a constant iteration? What's that process look like?
You want the official one or the behind the scenes?
So we're in Germany. Obviously the behind the scenes.
So we have something we call the Freaky Fridays.
Yes.
Everyone has the right to do nothing on Friday. And just we meet and we just ideate. And this is important. And sometimes we invite customers out of the blue. Maybe they are even competitors and they love it. And then we figure it out that they share the same problem. Sometimes we invite analysts. Sometimes we invite partners. And those are, we need to have internal input and external input. Mm-hmm. And we don't look at technology. We really try to always look at the boring things. What are the most boring things we want to fix it? And I can promise, starting with things that are boring, the best idea comes out of it.
Well, nobody wants to be bored.
Exactly. People want to be efficient.
Yeah, they want to be efficient. They want to do purposeful work. They want to be excited to show up in the morning. I actually think that's really great when I think about
it. And a lot of pretzel.
Yeah.
Yes, pretzels are great.
I could go for a pretzel right now, actually. Yeah. We're talking about this. I could have a pretzel at any time. But I think that's really interesting. When I was describing to a friend who's not in our industry at all what this show was about and what Salonis does, it's about optimizing and abstracting the boring things away from our workday, and so we can focus on the cool stuff like fun ideas or hanging out. So I love that you said that. All right, my final question for you, Eugenia, this has been really insightful, and I'm very curious for what you had to say since you get to see all the new stuff. When we have you on the show this time next year at the next Stellosphere, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today?
I think there will be some the platform adoption is, I expect a lot of new domain use cases.
Mm-hmm.
I might expect some new business model that maybe today someone will say, how did you do it?
Yeah.
I might expect also something like going in a domain that maybe today you will not think about it.
Yeah.
So that will be some initial things. Also, why not? Can you create new monetizations, maybe new products that will disrupt the way we do today? But we started to see this in the market. The market is changing from user-based into outcome-based.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What drives this behind the scene? So maybe.
Fantastic, Eugenia. Well, we look forward to talking about that, to hearing more stories about Freaky Fridays, and hopefully sharing a pretzel in that fantastic
room. Sure. Yes, pretzel there. So
oh, great. We'll have to check that out. Thank you for taking the time to hang out with us today. And thank you, Rob.
Yes.
Great questions, as always. And thank all of you for tuning in to our 2 days of Power Packed coverage here at Salonis Stellosphere in Munich, Germany. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.